Hello and welcome to Theme Park Cheat Codes, where we level up your theme park knowledge. Tokyo DisneySea is undoubtedly the most highly themed and deeply detailed theme park ever made, and you could spend all day without going on any rides and still be totally satisfied. However, the rides here are not to be missed, with some rides totally unique to DisneySea, as well as some other fresh takes on well-known Disney classics. In this video, we're going to talk about every single ride in the park, in ranking every ride in Tokyo DisneySea. We're going to start at number 21 with Jumping Jellyfish. As those lucky enough to have visited DisneySea could have probably guessed, we're going to start with the small flat rides in Triton's Kingdom. This delightful indoor kids area is full of cute details, and Ariel's Playground, which is an intricately detailed themed environment and a real hidden gem of the park. But the rides in this area are pretty standard off-the-shelf flat rides with some cute designs. Jumping Jellyfish sits in a darkened corner of the area, lit up only with UV lights, which does give the attraction a unique flair. But the up and down motion of the ride is so slow and tame, it quickly becomes dull, even for smaller guests. One for the very small children. Number 20 is the Whirlpool. Right next to the Jumping Jellyfish, this is a teacup style ride which is enhanced by some neat lighting and projections, but is another ride aimed squarely at the youngest of the guests. A ride that's more fun to watch than to ride on, in my opinion. Number 19 is Blowfish Balloon Race. Finishing off our trio of indoor rides in Triton's Kingdom, the Blowfish Balloon Race is similarly lacking in thrills, but does have the advantage of offering some elevated views of the area, as well as the adorable designs of the blowfish themselves. It also has a nice pizza smell from Sebastian's Calypso Kitchen next door. Number 18 is Jasmine's Flying Carpets. As far as Dumbo-style rides go, this one is actually very pretty. Themed around the Sultan's Palace, Jasmine's Flying Carpets is about as elegant as a spinner ride can get. My biggest problem with the ride isn't the theming, it's that it's in completely the wrong place. Arabian Coast is grand and elegant at the other end of the land, but here, around Sindbad, the walls are crumbling as it's on the outskirts of the town by the port. Jasmine's Flying Carpets totally uprooted this by plonking a gleaming white palace fountain right next to the Sindbad ride. I wouldn't have a problem with this kind of thing if it's for a ride that's worth it, but for a Dumbo clone? Nah, 18. Number 17 is Scuttle Scooters. Our last Mermaid Lagoon flat ride, this one gets bonus points for not only being a slightly more interesting ride, going both forwards and backwards, but also for being right on the river and being surrounded by colourful rockwork and waterfalls. It's pretty fun to venture down to the river and get close to the transit steamer line, which we'll talk about more later. Number 16 is Flounder's Flying Fish Coaster. DisneySea is quite an oddity, as its two only roller coasters are two of the less interesting rides in the park. Having said that, Flounder's Flying Fish Coaster does its job about as well as anyone could ask. Set into the ground to make it less intimidating, weaving through the water features and fountains, adorable ride vehicles and lush music make this a very special kiddie coaster. Number 15 is Caravan Carousel. A stark contrast to Jasmine's Flying Carpets, the Caravan Carousel is in exactly the right place. A carousel technically makes very little sense in the Arabian land, but the kinetic energy and playful melodies being slightly obscured by the gorgeous domed structure make it a perfect fit. And having it be two stories not only makes for a fun ride with better views of the land, but it also increases capacity. About as perfect a carousel as one could ask for. Number 14 is Nemo and Friends Sea Rider. Another one of DisneySea's few short-sighted blunders was replacing the iconic Storm Rider simulator that tied the story of Port Discovery together with a Finding Nemo ride to coincide with the release of Finding Dory. The pre-show uses a fun special effect, and the ride has randomized combinations like Star Tours, but none of that really makes up for it feeling like they're underusing the ride technology. The huge simulators with enormous screens made sense for the dramatic and adventurous Storm Rider, but having a ride that's main selling point is that it's cute feels like putting a sock on your hand. Number 13 is Big City Vehicles. American Waterfront's New York area is so lovingly filled with details, walking through the land is an absolute joy. But you know what's better than walking? Not walking! Riding in one of the unique vehicles being driven by one of DisneySea's world-class cast members is an intimate treat that grants you permission to enjoy the detailed theming at a relaxed pace while resting your feet. The ride usually has a very short wait, But even if you don't want to ride, you'll admire the life that the vehicles bring to this already bustling area of the park. Number 12, Toy Story Mania. If you've ridden this in the American parks or played the game on the Nintendo Wii, then you've ridden this one. Granted, DisneySea is much, much more pretty from the outside, and the queue line and station do have some quirks that make it fun to be in, but there's only so much I can get out of going from screen to screen and pulling a string. It doesn't help that this ride gets some of the longest queues in the entire park, and the outdoor portion of the queue is not at all as fun as the brief indoor portion. Still, competing with your friends or family for the highest score is always fun, and it's nice to get a little arm workout in between all the churros and popcorn. Number 11 is Electric Railway. This was the first ride I ever rode at DisneySea, and it was just a joy. Whether you're facing Tower of Terror and Port Discovery, or looking to Mediterranean Harbor and Mount Prometheus, an elevated look at the park allows you to take a deep breath and appreciate the scale of what the Imagineers achieved here. Off-ride, it adds a wonderful kinetic energy, and it's always nice to wave at the guests as they're riding too. Well worth a ride if you want to get from American Waterfront to Port Discovery, or vice versa, in style. Number 10 is Raging Spirits, another off-the-shelf coaster that is massively enhanced by the theming and special effects. This coaster has everything. A beautifully detailed queue line that takes you deeper and deeper into the excavation site, fire, water, mist, stunning views of the park, and constant head-chopper moments, but they all feel like they're trying to distract from the tepid coaster itself. Still, if you can embrace this coaster for what it is, you can have a great time on this one. Highly recommend riding at nighttime if possible, as the fire and mist effects really pop. Number 9 is Aquatopia. I once described this ride as pointless, because that's how it can feel when you're riding. You move, you stop, you spin, you stop, you go back, you stop, you spin more, you stop again, and it can feel a bit silly. But Aquatopia has grown on me to the point that I rarely spend a day at the park without riding it at least once. It totally occupies Port Discovery to the point that it's impossible to imagine the land without it. And it's really the only way to experience this area of the park. Riding in a group is always a blast as you try to keep track of your friend's vehicle and wave to them as you go around, wondering who's going to go where next. Another one I'd recommend at nighttime, as the lighting really adds a lot to the experience. The first ever trackless dark ride developed, Pooh's Honey Hunt Next Door would open first but was developed off the back of Aquatopia, the ride leans into the novelty of the trackless experience in a way that no other ride really has. Number 8 is Venetian Gondolas, another calm ride that's used more to populate an area and add kinetic energy. The Venetian Gondolas are the perfect romantic ride for this perfectly romantic park. The majority of Tokyo DisneySea's audience are couples, and this ride caters to them like no other. The charming cast members add a level of authenticity, bolstered even more by the stunningly accurate depictions of Venice, before you say ciao to some passers-by and end up in Mediterranean Harbor with a view of Mount Prometheus and fortress explorations that you can't get from anywhere else. Be aware that the ride does close during show and greetings on the harbor, so it's worth planning ahead a little for this one. If you're willing to slow your pace down to match this ride, or want to take some special photos of your group or of the park itself, this one is not to be missed. Number 7 is Soaring Fantastic Flight. Another ride largely identical to those found in other parks around the world, Soaring Fantastic Flight sets itself apart with its dedication to storytelling, as well as the G at the end of Soaring. Expanding on the fan favorite Society of Explorers and Adventurers, which started right here at Tokyo DisneySea, the character of Camellia Falco embodies wanderlust and ambition. The deeper into the queue you get, the more you're rewarded with the depth of storytelling and the gorgeous pieces of art before you reach the pre-show, which is as subtle as it is jaw-droppingly beautiful. It's remarkable that they were able to exercise such restraint and create such a feeling of awe and wonder simply by using projections. Even the ride bays have a little trick up their sleeves using the lifelike projections too. Having said all that, this is currently the newest ride in the park and the queues reflect that. So if you only have one day and you've done it abroad before, this one might be worth skipping. Number 6 is 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. 20,000 Leagues is just so utterly unique that it's impossible for me to put it any lower than this. The animatronics have limited motion, sure, but this ride is more about the immersiveness than anything else. The instant you enter the queue and spiral downwards towards the station, you're totally enveloped in the story, and when you see your vehicle, you know it's going to be unlike anything else. The intimate and intricately detailed vehicles set the tone perfectly and really sell the story through the sound, lighting, and bubble effects. The portholes restrict your view, but they also force you to lean in and really look around yourself, which is encouraged further through the use of the joystick-controlled spotlights. There are some sweet gags that harken back to The Haunted Mansion or Pirates of the Caribbean, but the real draw here is the depth and detail of the environment. The big squid's pretty cool too. Number 5. Tower of Terror. Some people say DisneySea has the best Tower of Terror in the world, but I don't think that's really true. The best theming, yeah. The best story, absolutely. But the actual ride profile is so short and dull that it can feel underwhelming, especially after so much anticipation. Having said that, if you set your expectations accordingly, you're in for a real treat with this one. The story begins when you see the majestic building from afar, highly detailed and a perfect brazen introduction to the character who constructed it, Harrison Hightower III. The queue does an excellent job of building the story and gradually letting us know more and more about Hightower until we reach the pre-show and we meet the stolen idol, Shiriki Utundu, who disappears right before your eyes in one of the quickest and most jaw-dropping special effects Disney have ever pulled off. The deep, rich storytelling is really what makes this attraction stand out, even if the actual drop sequence leaves something to be desired. Number 4 is the Transit Steamer Line. Yeah, this is probably going to be my most contentious pick, but hear me out. What's the best thing about DisneySea? It's not the rides. It's the stunning level of detail from the very big to the very small. It's the fact that no matter which direction you look, from anywhere in the park, you're going to see something breathtakingly beautiful. So what could be better than taking a boat all the way around every part of the park? Well, 3 things could be better because this is number 4, as I wasn't quite bold enough to put it at number 1. But admiring the entire park from this low level, at a relaxed pace, is always a highlight of my day. And at nighttime, it feels even more special. A great touch is that the soundtrack changes depending on the port you're traveling through, so you always feel completely immersed in the part of the park you're looking at. I do recommend taking the full park-wide tour, as some of the boats only travel from one area to another, and it's really great to see every port like this. The ride is an absolute treat, and one of the shortest waits in the park, so there's no excuse to miss it. Number 3 is Indiana Jones and the Temple of the Crystal Skull. Like Tower of Terror, Indiana Jones and the Temple of the Crystal Skull, no, it's not based on that movie, and it actually opened years before, in 2001, starts telling its story as soon as you see the ride building. The huge pyramid begs to be explored and rewards you more and more the closer you get. Outside, you'll weave through the trees, getting glimpses of the temple, before finding yourself inside the enormous pyramid, filled with harrowing sculptures and the skeletons of the unlucky adventurers that came before you. Deeper you go, the space becomes more cramped before you finally board your vehicle and get on your way. Similar to its sister at Disneyland in California, the ride is non-stop thrills and chills as you dart through this forbidden place, being attacked by skeletons and a giant snake, before reaching the iconic boulder coming towards you. Some ways this ride differs from the one at Disneyland are that this ride generally has a blue color scheme, which gives it more of an otherworldly feel. I prefer the orange myself as it feels a bit more rooted in reality. But DisneySea also has a tornado effect in the main chamber and a very angry deity that blows a smoke ring right at the vehicle. A joy from start to finish, this ride is one of the best in the world, but only 3rd on our list. Number 2, Journey to the Center of the Earth. The moment you enter DisneySea, you experience the most perfect reveal in any theme park around the world when you're introduced to Mount Prometheus. But unlike the castle, this park icon is home to a ride, and the ride at the center of the greatest theme park in the world had to be something magnificent. Journey to the Center of the Earth feels like the culmination of everything Walt Disney Imagineering had learned up until this point. A highly detailed experience full of joy, wonder, surprise, peril, and thrills, whilst never sacrificing immersion or storytelling for a second. The curiosity of the artifacts in the queue, the extension of the ride into the Terravators, the ethereal station full of smoke and enormous moving set pieces, the magic of the twinkling crystals and bioluminescent mushrooms, juxtaposed with the intimidating endless ocean and the enormous lava monster. Some people are disappointed with the brevity of the fast part of the ride, but no ride more perfectly embodies DisneySea's founding mission of using highly detailed, ultra-immersive storytelling and state-of-the-art ride systems to create unforgettable adventures. Number 1. Sindbad's Storybook Voyage. Sure, no ride better embodies DisneySea's founding mission than Journey to the Center of the Earth. But what if DisneySea's founding mission was actually a little misguided? When the park opened, people fawned over its mesmerizing, no-expense-spared approach to small details and imposing architecture alike, but they felt that there wasn't enough for their young children to do. The park was lacking the wholesome magic of its naive and nostalgic neighbor, Disneyland. Sindbad's Storybook Voyage took a ride that originally was dark and grim and reimagined it with an unforgettable Alan Menken score, an adorable fluffy friend, and other enhancements across the ride that gave it the charm and heart that Tokyo DisneySea so desperately needed. All of this, combined with the high capacity of the ride, giving it constantly the shortest wait time in the park, makes Sindbad an unmissable hidden gem, and in my opinion, the best ride in the best park in the world. If you want to learn more about Sindbad's Storybook Voyage, I've made an entire video pointing out every single thing that makes the ride so great, so please check that out. If you want to see more videos like this in the future, please subscribe and hit the bell icon to be notified every time we make an upload. Thank you so much to Bea and the Sabaran family for your kind support on Patreon. If you'd like to get early access and other special perks, please check that out in the description, where you'll also find the 8-Bit Theme Park gift shop, where we have t-shirts, hats, and other accessories. Please remember, this is all my personal opinion as someone who lives nearby and visits the park relatively often. If you have a different take, I'd love to discuss it in the comments. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.